But then he lets us know of the consequence of this behavior, of Muslims disagreeing with each other. He lets us know of the consequence of this. The consequence of this, of course, we are divided, we're disunited, but the real consequence of this is in the next generation. Not in your own generation, in the next generation. Allah says, وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُورِثُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ. And it is no doubt, those who were given the book to inherit after them, those who inherited the book after them. Allah didn't say utul kitab, they were given the book. Innal mu'mineen ba'dahum. No, not the believers after them. Innal ladheena urithul kitaba min ba'dihim. Those who were given the book in inheritance after them. Meaning, they got it from their fathers, from their mothers. They got the book, they got the religion because they were born in Muslim families. They were born in a community which was engaged in disagreement. What happened to these kids, this next generation of Muslims supposedly? لَفِي شَكِّمْ مِنْهُ مُرِيبٍ. First of all, they have no confidence in their faith. لَفِي شَكْ. Shak is a kind of doubt that takes the confidence away from you. You're not sure about something. And then murib, a kind of raib, a kind of doubt that keeps you from going forward. So every time they, you know, there's an issue of halal or haram, the right or wrong according to the dictates of this deen, they're not so sure if that's the thing they're supposed to do. The next generation is in doubt about the religion altogether. Because the generation before was too busy fighting. It was too busy fighting. You know something that happened in the Muslim world that those of you that come from the Muslim world already know? In the Muslim world, let's take Pakistan, India, for example, where I come from. Muslims are basically divided into multiple camps. But if you want to generalize, there are two basic camps. There's the religious Muslims, somehow religious, whatever affiliation they may have. And then there's the more secularized, modernized Muslims. The Muslims that are not very religious. The Muslims that are sort of cut off from religious learning altogether. And you know, the people, they all call themselves Muslims, by the way. But you know, if you ask the average educated, secularized, or semi-secularized Muslim, why don't you learn more about the religion? Why don't you practice it? I mean, after all, you're Muslim. Why don't you practice it? You know what they say? Oh, these mullahs, they're always fighting each other. What am I, you want me to turn like them? You want me to be like them? Go into every masjid. One guy's giving khutbah against that guy, that guy's giving khutbah against that guy. Every group is saying, you're not in this group, don't come to this masjid. Don't go to that masjid. This is as crazy as it gets in the Muslim world. And we're no exception. We're not as crazy because the law doesn't let us be. It's the only reason. But I've seen insanity here too. In the masajid, people speaking against other groups, people speaking against imams and da'is. You don't know them, you have never spoken to them in person, but yet you have the audacity to say, this person is not on the haq, they're evil, they're on falsehood, this and that. It is to the level of ugliness. So the average Muslim who doesn't even come for five prayers, doesn't even pray five times at home, the only time they show up at the masjid by accident, by the mercy of Allah, is for Jumu'ah prayer, and they hear this nonsense. They hear this on the minbar. Would they ever want to come back? Would they ever be sure about their religion? They fall into more doubt about it. وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُورِثُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ لَفِي شَكِّمْ مِنْهُ مُرِيبٍ. I go around the country, and subhanAllah, wherever I go, I meet some parents, they say, I want you to talk to my kids. Can I invite you to my house? I want you to talk to my kids. And I talk to these kids, and you know the kinds of questions they have? I get Muslim families, for generations, and their kids are asking me questions like, how do you know for sure God exists? What's wrong with homosexuality? What's wrong? They're not killing anyone. What's wrong with it? So what if I hang out with guys? I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. It's not like I'm, you know, doing anything worse. And if somebody does drugs or things, I mean, these are Muslim kids asking these questions. They're not asking in front of their parents, they're asking away from their parents, so I don't tell their parents, but the fact is, they're in doubt. They're in doubt. Where did this doubt come from? The generation before was too busy in argument. Why were they arguing? They were arguing because they had this ego inside. I'll call it out. I'll be blunt this time. Across this country, I've seen arguments like 8 Taraweeh versus 20 Taraweeh. Eid on Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday or Friday. Right? The disagreement within the Muslim. Should our imam be an Arab? Should be an African American? Should he be a Desi? Should he be this or that? Right? Who should give the khutbah? These are the disagreements between the Muslims. And a lot of times the Muslims who are disagreeing about these things, fighting tooth and nail, don't even know what the issue is. They don't even know why Eid should be on this day or that day. They just say, that guy is a different race from me, in the back of their head, therefore I can never agree with him. Oh, those Arabs. Oh, those Desis, they're all the same. Oh, those brothers, they don't understand. That community doesn't understand. And they're fighting it out. They're fighting it out. And who's being lost in all of these fights? Our youth. The ones that are suffering is the next generation. Wallahi, I tell you one true story and I'm done, inshallah ta'ala. One true story that hurts me. It hurts me. I was in this community and I was invited to two dinners. The community was half Indo-Pak predominantly and the other half was Arab community. And because I speak a little bit of Arabic, I broke the ice with the Arab brothers and my Punjabi's okay. So I made good friends with Desi uncles too. So I got invited one night to a Desi household where all the brothers got together. Of course, which brothers? The Desi brothers. And the other night I got invited to the Arab community and, you know, I hung out with the brothers on the other side. The fight between this community, no need to mention names, was which imam should we hire? Should he be an Indian imam? Because the majority is Indo-Pak and we're Hanafi, so we should have a Hanafi imam. And the other side, no, we need an Arab imam because Arabic is the language of Islam. And, you know, the Sunnah is to speak in, you know, the Islam, actually not the Sunnah, but the Islam promotes the Arabic language, therefore we need an Arab imam. So who was promoting an Indian imam? The Indo-Paks. Who was promoting an Arab imam? The Arabs. And when I go to one side, they're trying to say, why don't you convince them of an Indian imam? And I go to the Arab families, and what do they say? Why don't you convince them of an Arab imam? And I went to both of them, and I said the same thing. Let's assume you get the top-notch scholar that you want. The best scholar, cracks the best jokes in Hyderabadi Urdu or, you know, or in, you know, dialectical Egyptian, Ammiya, and you're really happy with him. Your kids, the Indo-Pak kids, the African-American kids, the Arab kids, the Turk kids, the Indonesian kids, the kids of the people that have recently accepted Islam from varying ethnicities, their kids, can they understand these imams? No. They're not really concerned about their next generation. They're not. Who are they concerned about? Themselves. It's like this nostalgia of back home. I want to feel like it used to feel when I was younger and I used to listen to that imam, so I want my imam to remind me of the old days where I used to be. And the one being sacrificed in all of this is who? The kids that are barely awake in the khutbah. The kids when the khatira is being presented, they're outside playing basketball. Or worse. Or worse. Who? What are we doing this for? Who's going to be filling these rows in 20 years? Who's going to be there? We haven't thought ahead. And in these arguments we have against each other, the only one suffering is the next generation. They're the only one suffering. There's nobody to talk to them. You see these youth, right? They have problems. Your kids, the vast majority of Muslim kids, they go to public school. They do. And in public school, everything goes. I mean, I went to public school in New York in the 90s, and that was bad. But nothing. Those were good times compared to now. A lot has changed in 12 years. It's insanely different. Your kids hear things, they see things, they know things that you don't even know exist. They have vocabulary that's out of your scope. They know words you've never heard before. But if you knew what they mean, you'd have a heart attack. And your boy at school, or your daughter at school, in high school, some boy comes to her, and he says, you have pretty eyes. Want to go out sometime? And your boy at school, some other girl comes to him and says, you're kind of cute. Is he going to tell you? He's not going to tell you. Because if he tells you, you're going to go crazy. I should ship you back to Pakistan. You know, this is my solution. Or I'm, as a punishment, I'm putting you in Islamic school. Or you better memorize Quran now. You think that's going to solve the problem? Our kids have no one to talk to. So you know who they end up talking to? They end up talking to their non-Muslim friends who say, hey, she thinks you're cute, right? That's probably a good thing. Go for it, man. So they cut themselves off from their parents. And they find a new affiliation with those who have no religion. Those who have no values. Whose fault is all of this? Whose fault is all of this? It is us, the elders, I myself included, I'm a parent too. We are too busy in these petty disagreements. And we've lost sight of the bigger priority, which is our children. Our kids.